talking about fruit today. If anyone has your Bibles with you, I hope everyone has your Bibles with you. You can turn to John 15. We're going to hang out there for a while. And everybody should have gotten some grapes when you came in this morning, all right? Does anybody not have some grapes? Just put your hand up. You're allowed to put your hand up. All right, we got some couple people down here. That's my friend, is it Isaac? Is that your name? Man, I remembered his name. He's going to hand out some grapes, so just put your hand up. We're going to be talking about fruit today, because Jesus talked a lot about fruit. Am I in the way? No, that looks good. Okay. So first of all, who enjoys fruit? Does anybody like fruit? Almost everybody. What's your favorite fruit?
Grapes.
Grapes. It's a gold star for today. Why do you like fruit? Like, what is it about fruit that you like? Just somebody. This is going to be a little interactive today, okay? I don't know what Mark usually does, but this is going to be a little interactive.
So always good when it's fresh.
You like when it's fresh? You like when it's fresh? Okay.
Crisp and juicy.
Crisp? Juicy? What do you guys over here like about fruit? Nothing. They don't like anything about fruit. Yes, ma'am.
It's easy to get to real fast.
I'm sorry?
It's easy to get to real fast. You don't have to.
Oh, yeah, it's fast food. Okay, it's fast food. You can just grab it off the vine and eat it. All right, well, those are all excellent answers. Fruit is delicious, isn't it? It's life-giving. It's nourishing. Jesus talked a lot about fruit. So let's just jump right in here today on John chapter 15, verses 1. He says, I am the true vine. My Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes or cleanses so that it may bear more fruit. So we have a few different players in this story emerging right away. Jesus says, I am the true vine. Now, why didn't he just say, I am a vine? Because Jesus repeatedly in the scripture said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to the Father except through me. And there's a lot of people today, just as there were back then, that say, you know, there's a lot of different ways to God. You know, it doesn't really matter who you believe in or who you trust in. All paths lead to the same God, right? Well, that's not what Jesus said. And that's not what the Bible teaches us. So we really need to put our faith and our hope in Jesus, because he is the true vine. And then he says, my Father is the vine dresser. Some translations say the gardener. All right, so who has a garden in here? Anybody have a garden or a vine or like you grow grapes or anything? Okay, lots of gardeners, all right? Now, what's the function of a gardener? Like, what do you do as the gardener? Some of you really wish you knew. Okay, here we go. What do you do as a gardener back there?
You grow food.
All right, you grow stuff, you grow flowers. So the gardener or the vine dresser, his job is to put the plant in the best possible position to bear fruit. I mean, if you're a gardener, you hope that your plants bear fruit, right? So everybody nod yes.
Yes.
Okay. You don't hope that you do all this work and then the branches just dry up and go away, right? All right, so that's what the gardener does. He helps the branches to bear fruit. Now, it also says the gardener or the vine dresser here kicks out any branches that don't bear fruit. You know, if you've got some dead, dry, withering branches, you don't want them hanging around. They're just taking up space. So you got to get rid of them. Now, we also have the branches. So the branches in this context would be the believers. Okay, in this section of Scripture, Jesus had pulled his disciples away, and he's talking to his disciples, and he's saying, look, you are the branches. You're the people who have put their faith and their trust in Christ and the branches, all right? But there's one more thing that this passage is talking about, and that's fruit, okay? So what do you think this fruit is? That kind of baffled me for a while, actually. I thought, man, this must be some deep theological concept that I'm just having a hard time grasping. You know, what is this fruit? So I did some studying, I did some praying, I did some research, and I thought, you know, maybe I'm just overthinking this. Maybe it's really simple. So we got, so I'm thinking, you know, let's say this is an apple tree, okay? So this is an apple tree. And what does the fruit of an apple tree look like? All right, now this is not a trick question, so Scott, you can probably answer this one. What does the fruit of an apple tree look like?
Looks like an apple.
It looks like an apple. All right, let's do one more. Scott said he was going to heckle me, so I figured I would heckle him first. All right, now here's another one. We got some grapes here. Let's pretend this is a grapevine, okay, kind of like that one up there. All right, so now we have a grapevine and we have grapes hanging on it. What does the fruit of a grapevine look like?
Grapes.
Grapes. Man, you guys are good. This is going to be easy. All right, so now we have a Jesus vine. Jesus says, I'm the true vine, okay? We have a Jesus vine. Everybody see that? I'll get over here. Alright, so what does the fruit of a Jesus vine look like?
Jesus.
That's not too hard, is it? The fruit of a Jesus vine is going to look like, talk like, walk like, act like, think like, love like Jesus. Just like the fruit of a grapevine looks like, smells like, tastes like, a grape. Oh, and you can eat your grapes here this morning if you want. That's fine. Just save a couple till the end because we're going to use them at the end. That's good. All right. So that's what the fruit is. The more we look like, act like, walk like, taste like Jesus, we're bearing fruit. Now, I had this big revelation a couple weeks ago as I was preparing for this message. So I went running into the kitchen and I saw Cindy. I said, Cindy, I got this big revelation. The fruit that Jesus wants us to manifest is simply looking like, talking like, acting like, walking like him. And she starts singing this little song or humming this little tune. And I want to play for you what she was humming. It's kind of cute. Can you roll that note?
Now I'm the king of the slingers, VIP. I've reached the top and had to stop, and that's what's bothering me. I want to be a man cub. And stroll right into town and be just like the other men. I'm tired of moping around. Oh, ooh, I want to be like you. I want to walk like you, talk like you, too. You see, it's true. I ain't like me.
That's Jungle Book. Did anybody ever see the Jungle Book movie? It's pretty cool, isn't it? Most of you have seen it. Now, all right, I understand King Louis, that's King Louis the monkey, okay, the orangutan. He didn't have it all right. His motivations were not exactly pure in wanting to be a human, okay? He wanted power and fame. He wanted to control the fire and all that. I get that. But the one thing he did get, he understood that to be human meant something. He couldn't just wake up one day and say, okay, I'm human. That's it. I'm done. Okay? He understood that to be human actually meant something. He said, you know, I'm tired of being a monkey. I'm tired of swinging around. I want to walk like you. I want to talk like you. I want to be like you. I want to act like you. I want to go where humans do. I want to go where they go. I want to do what they do. He knew that it meant something. And that's what Jesus is talking about here. When we have the fruit of being connected to the vine means something. It doesn't mean just saying, well, you know, I prayed the sinner's prayer when I was 4, and now I'm done. Okay, I got my ticket to heaven. No, it means we got to be connected to the vine of Jesus so that we are looking like him, walking like him, talking like him, acting like him. And you say, is that really possible? I mean, is it really possible for people to do that? Well, I want to read a little story for you. You probably all remember about a month ago. There was a horrible, horrible killing in, I think, South Carolina, Charleston. This guy walks into a church, a white guy walks into a black church, goes into a Bible study of all places, and starts murdering people, just shooting them up, about 9 people, just killed them. Can you imagine that you're sitting in this room and someone comes in and starts murdering your spouse, your kids, your friends? It was horrible. It was tragic. But what was even more incredible was the response of some of the friends and families and relatives of the victims of this tragedy. It was just incredible. Here's just one example. There was a lady here named Bethane Middleton Brown. She represented the family of the Reverend DePayne Middleton Doctor. And this is what she said. DePayne Doctor was my sister. And I just thank you. Now get this. She's looking at the accused, okay, the guy who shot everyone up. She's looking at him via video at his hearing, okay? So she's facing the accused. She says, I thank you on behalf of my family for not allowing hate to win. For me, I'm a work in progress, and I acknowledge that I'm very angry. But one thing DePayne always joined in my family with is that she taught me we are the family that love built. We have no room for hate. We have to forgive you. I pray God on your soul. And then she ends up by saying, and I also thank God I won't be around when your judgment day comes with him. Now, the thing I like about this testimony is that, first of all, it's human. It's real. She says, look, I'm a work in process. I don't got this all together. I'm angry. Okay, the human side of me is coming out. But the other thing that she says is I'm connected to the vine of Jesus. She says, I'm a branch on this vine. And because I'm connected to the Jesus vine, the fruit that I have to display in this situation is forgiveness. That's the fruit I have to display. And that's exactly what she did. Now, a couple thousand years ago, Jesus was hanging on the cross. They had brutally beaten him. They had falsely accused him. They put nails in his feet and nails in his hands, and he's hanging on the cross, and he looks down on the very people who are killing him. And what does he say? Does anybody remember what he says to those people? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So do you think these people in Charleston look a little bit like Jesus? Absolutely. And you and I can too. So how do we do that? Well, first of all, God gives us the power to do that. In 2 Peter, this is a really cool verse. He says, seeing that his divine power has granted to us everything pertaining to life and godliness through the true knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. For by these he had granted to us his precious and magnificent promises, so that by them you may become partakers of the divine nature, having escaped corruption that is in the world. So that by his promises you and I can become partakers of his divine nature. Think about that for a minute. Jesus, who is divine, lowers himself to become human so that we can become divine, so that we can take on his nature. To me, that's mind-boggling. I'm having a hard time wrapping my arms around that one. But that's what Jesus wants. He wants us to be so connected to him, so nourished by him, so fed by him, that we take on his divine nature. We become like him, just like those people in Charleston did. So that's one way we do it, through God's help, through the help of the Holy Spirit. The other way we do it is we see this as we continue on in some of these verses. Let's go to verse 4. Jesus says, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away as a branch and dries up, and they gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. Now, when you're reading your Bible, when you're studying Scripture, I'll give you a little hint. If you see a word repeated more than a couple of times in a text, like in a chapter or a paragraph, I would call that a key word. That means the author is trying to get your attention. So what you do is you go back and look at that word, and you study it, and you're trying to figure out what the author is trying to tell you. Well, here, Jesus uses this word abide or remain 10 times in the first 10 verses of this Scripture. 10 times. So do you think abide is important, or this concept of remaining is important? Absolutely. So what I did was I went to my little Bible dictionary and I looked up abide, and this is what it means in the context of this Scripture. It means of the relation in which one person or thing stands with another, thus to remain in or with someone, to be and remain united with him, one with heart and mind and will. To remain united with someone, with him in heart and mind and will. So it's to remain. It's a long-term thing. It's not just a once-and-done kind of thing. I want to tell you today why I married my wife. All right? On August 4th, we're going to celebrate our 36th wedding anniversary. Okay? And that's a long time, so it's been very cool. What I'm going to tell you today, I've never told anyone this, why I decided to marry my wife, why I asked her to marry me. And the reason is because I got really tired of dating her. Okay? Now, you're going to say, that's kind of crass. I can't believe you just said that. But I did. I got tired of dating her. We were high school sweethearts, okay? And so we started going out in 10th grade. I had no idea why she said yes when I asked her out, but thank God she did. And so we would go out. We'd go to a football game. We'd have a hamburger afterward. We'd have a good time. And then I would take her home, and she would go to her place, and I would go to my place. And then we'd go out again, or I'd see her at school, or we'd go to a band competition or something, and we'd have a good time. And then she would go to her place, and I would go to my place. Now, if you've ever dated anyone, if you've ever been close to someone, isn't that a drag? Somebody nodded yes. That's a drag. I got tired of saying goodbye. So finally, I asked her to marry me 50 times, and she said yes. And that's why I wanted to abide with her. I didn't want to have to say goodbye again. I wanted to go to sleep with her at night. I wanted to wake up with her in the morning. I wanted to hang out with her as much as possible during the day. I wanted to abide with her. And that's what Jesus is saying here. When he says abide, he doesn't mean, you know, once a week. He says, look, I want to be married to you. The Bible refers to Jesus as the bridegroom and those who have put their faith and trust in him as the bride. If you've put your faith in Christ, you are his bride. He wants you to abide with him. He wants you to talk to him when you go to sleep. He wants you to wake up in the morning with him with a song of praise on your lips saying, God, how can I be with you all day today bearing fruit? How can I act like you and walk like you and talk like you? How can I be fruit for you today all the day long? That's what he wants. He wants us to abide with him. And you know what I like about being married the most now that I am married? I like abiding with my wife. I like the fact that I don't have to take her home. Well, I do. I take her to our home. And you know what? I still take her out on dates, too. It's not that I didn't like dating. We go out on dates all the time. We go dancing and whatever. So it's all good. But Jesus wants us to abide with him. Because when we do that, we bear fruit. So let's just take a beat here. Let's just take a pause. I want to ask you a question. How would you characterize your relationship with Jesus today? You know, for some of us, we may not really know him all that well. Maybe you're here because a friend invited you, and you're not sure about all this God stuff and faith stuff and whatnot. And that's fine. That's awesome, because you're here. This is where God wants you. Maybe some of you are dating Jesus. Okay, maybe you're dating Jesus. Maybe you pick him up, and you take him to church with you on Sunday morning, and you have a really good time, and life is good, and then he goes home, and you go home, and you don't really think about him a whole lot until maybe, I don't know, Bible study Wednesday night, or choir practice or something, then you take him home again, you know? But are we really bearing the fruit? Are we really walking with him? Are we really becoming more like him? Now, some of you I know are married to Jesus, you know? You go to bed at night and you're thinking about God, you're thinking about your day, you're thinking about how you've interacted with Jesus that day. You wake up with a song of praise on your lips. You wake up saying, wow, God, you just gave me another day of life. I guess you want me to live for you today. I guess you want me to bear fruit today. And then you go all throughout your day saying, Jesus, how can I be more like you today? Some of you are married to Jesus. That's awesome. That's what he wants. But no matter where we're at, the good news of this text, the good news of the whole entire Bible, is that God doesn't want to leave any single one of us where we are at today. Okay? Even if you think you're the absolute best bride of Christ there can be, there's more for us. There's more for us. And it comes through abiding with him and bearing fruit. Amen? Do you guys say amen in this church?
Amen.
All right, let's have an amen on that one, all right? Amen. Just had to check. Wasn't sure. All right. Let's read a few more verses. Let's go to verse 7 to 11. In verse 7, Jesus talks about abiding. Now, I love this because I'm a very linear kind of person. I like progression. And Jesus kind of walks us right through it, okay? Bear fruit, abide in the vine. Now he's going to tell us how to abide, all right? Verse 7, if you abide in me or remain in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. Just as the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be made full. So here we see kind of the key to abiding with Christ. And Jesus says here, look, I'm the best example. Jesus says, I'm the best example. And what he says in verse 10 is, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. You see, when Jesus was on this earth, he had to stay connected to the Father. He knew he had to. And the way he did that was by living a life of obedience to the Father. That's how he did it. So there were a day in history came along where God said, okay, Jesus, my son, you're going to go down to earth now. You're going to become human. And he's like, okay, I can do that. So he did. He obeyed. And then after 30 years or so, God said, okay, Jesus, it's time for you to start your earthly ministry. You're going to preach, teach, heal people, and drive out demons. That's what you're going to do, to show people that the kingdom of God is on this earth, is with men. He's like, okay, I can do that. It sounds like fun. So he did that. He did all those things. And then God said, okay, Jesus, now it's time for you to be mocked, scorned, spit at. You're going to have all your friends leave you, and one of your best friends is going to betray you. And he's like, okay, I can do that. I'll be obedient to that. And then God says, all right, now it's time for you to be killed mercilessly on the cross. A seriously, seriously painful death. And that's where Jesus took a little bit of a beat, didn't he? That's theater lingo. He took a beat. He paused. And he's like, God, I don't know about that one. You want me to do that? He prayed all night long, and he said, okay, God, I will be obedient to you, even unto a brutal, brutal death. And he did. And of course, he was raised again, and it was just an awesome, beautiful thing. But Jesus is our best example of what he's talking about, abiding. Abiding is not just saying, okay, I believe in you, God, I'm done. No, abiding is obedience to his word and living every single day like we mean it, just like Jesus did. And you know, the Bible, one thing I like about the Bible, it's you read it, there's all kinds of stuff in here. I mean, we have no excuse not to be obedient to his word. I mean, if you think about it, we've got the Ten Commandments. That's a checklist, basically. If we all followed the Ten Commandments, this would be a great world, wouldn't it? But here's one in Galatians. The Apostle Paul kind of digs into this a little bit. So let's see exactly what this looks like. Paul says, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Okay, so the fruit of abiding with Jesus is reading his word, studying his word, and when we come across scriptures like this that say, boy, if you want to look like Jesus, you should have love, you should have peace, patience, joy, self-control. Then what we do is, like Jesus says here, pray, and I will answer your prayers. So when we pray for things that we know Jesus already wants, he's going to answer those prayers, isn't he? So if we say, Jesus, you know, I'm really not a very patient person. I really lose my temper a lot. I need some self-control. He will answer those prayers for us because he wants us to stay connected to him, and he wants us to become more like him. You see how that works, this living in obedience kind of lifestyle? And then the Apostle Paul goes on to say there's other types of fruit, too. We've been talking about good fruit, but, you know, there's bad fruit, too. And he says, now the deeds of the flesh, that's bad fruit, actually, they're called sins. The deeds of the flesh are evident. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, disputes, dissensions, factions, drunkenness, carousing, envying. I mean, the list goes on and on because, people dream up new ways of sinning every day. The list goes on and on. And so, you know, we can either abide in Christ by studying his word, by getting to know him, by hanging out with other Christians, by figuring out what it means to be Jesus and to grow and look like and act like and walk like and talk like and love like and serve like Jesus. Or we can abide in these fleshly areas. And we can just kind of intentionally and willfully do some of these other things, sexually immoral things, drunkenness, envying, strife, anger, bitterness, you know, you name it. We have to abide in one camp or the other. And Jesus wants us to abide with him through obedience to his word. So there's a couple of things I'd like you to do today. So what do we do with all this? This abiding and bearing fruit. Abiding and bearing fruit. Well, the first thing I'd like you to do is inspect your fruit. You know, you all have some grapes there. So you can inspect your fruit. And I hope you all have good fruit in your bag. I did not intentionally put any bad fruit in it. But, you know, do a little soul searching today. Say, God, where really is my relationship with you? Am I just dating you? Do I need to get married to you today? If God were to look at your life, or better yet, if your friend or your relative or your spouse were to look at your life, would they see Jesus? Would they see someone who looks and acts and walks like and talks like and is like Jesus? Or would they see something else? Maybe that would be a good exercise. Ask your spouse, ask a friend. So that's the first thing I'd like you to do. Do a little bit of soul searching. And then the second thing I would like you to do today is if you can't honestly and wholeheartedly say, yes, I am married to Jesus. I consider him the bridegroom and I am his bride. And every day I wake up saying, God, how can I become more like you today? If that's not you, I challenge you to do something about that. Do something about that. In fact, I'm going to be up here during the last hymn just worshiping along with you. If you want to come up here and talk to me about that, I'd be happy to kind of, you know, point you in the right direction, get you going in that direction. We'll be hanging out after the service if you want to talk to me or some other people here about how to do that. Because that's what Jesus wants for you. It's what he wants for me. It's what he wants for everyone in this room, is to be married to us. He wants us to abide and bear fruit. Now, the third thing, this is something I'm going to do for you. I'm going to be praying today that tomorrow morning when we wake up, when all of us wake up, that we have the King Louis song on our mind. Okay? I'm going to pray that you see that monkey swinging around saying, I want to be more like you. I want to walk like you. I want to talk like you. I want to be like you. I hope we all have that song running through our minds tomorrow morning. But what I'd like us to do is change the words just a little bit at the end, okay? And what I want those words to be is, because you see it's true, a man like me, or a woman like me, or a teenager like me, or a child like me, can learn to be just like Jesus too. Okay? Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. We thank you for, and these are literally your words. You were talking to your disciples, and you're talking to us now, Lord. There's not, Jesus, you were leaving this earth soon. You were giving your disciples your last words, the most important thing you wanted them to hear before you left this earth. And that was to abide with Jesus and bear fruit. Abide and bear fruit. There's nothing more important we can do with that. Because if we do that, that's going to encompass everything you taught while you were here. Lord, I pray that you would sink that into our hearts today. Sink that into our minds. Lord, no matter where we're at on the spectrum of faith, Lord, take us to another level. Help us to become more like you. In Jesus' name, amen.